So thank you for coming. I'm Kris. I'm working for King. You may have heard it's not the King. The company is called King. You may have heard it's like, I don't know. Anyone played Candy Crush here? Okay, one person. Pardon? Okay, so today we'll try to make something similar, maybe not exactly the same, but we'll try to make a match-3 game, and we'll try to do it to be able to run it in the browser. We'll use Emscripten for that. It's mostly tutorial, but in the beginning I'll explain how we'll do it and what we will use to accomplish that. If you're really impatient, you can play it right now. It's online. So, hello. So, what does it mean to be in cross-platform these days? Obviously, it's a bit different than a few years ago. Right now, you would like to support desktop, mobile, and even the web. We would like to write the one code for everything, which is not that easy. However, it's possible. For the applications, we have a lot of options. This option we'll try today. Obviously, there is like Chirp and WebAssembly, but WebAssembly is not ready yet, unfortunately. So what about games? Games, you can use engines, and as well, we can use Emscripten and anything else to deploy to the web. So, how to combine C++ with JavaScript, which is the exciting part of making anything for the web browsers. We have a lot of tools. However, they require a lot of effort from us to write in JavaScript mostly. So what about C++ in the web? We have a few options these days. The first one is Emscripten. Anyone has used Emscripten before? Awesome. So just to wrap it up, Emscripten is just based on LLVM. It creates JavaScript out of LLVM AST.
What's the ASM.js format?
Pardon?
What is the ASM.js format?
So that's just JavaScript, which is which might be run on the browser.
So ASM.js is a specific convention for annotating every value in JavaScript with a special operator that kind of gives type information to the JavaScript compiler, like prefix every integral, every variable access that is integral, prefix it with a unary plus. So the compiler can then say, okay, so I expect this thing to be an integer, I optimize my code generation for that and just have this escape hatch, but what if it isn't? But the common path is then doesn't need to do slow type dispatching.
Okay, so the comment was, what SMAJS is. I won't repeat that, it was just too long. Sorry about that. So, hello world with Emscripten, it's quite easy. We just have a C++ code, we compile it, and we get the index HTML we can run on the browser. Quite awesome. Another option is Chirp. They claim to be a bit faster than Emscripten. Although the main difference, the memory allocation, they use dynamic allocation. Emscripten, it's creating a table of array in the beginning. I actually didn't compare them, so I don't know. We'll use Emscripten because it's supporting SDL2, which we'll be using. And the final is WebAssembly. Well, we cannot use it as much yet because it's still in progress. However, sooner or later, we'll be able to use it. It's a bit different approach. Here, we just run the compiled code on the browser. We don't have to run JavaScript, so the performance should be faster. Obviously, we have more problems with the security here, but I guess that might be solved somehow. So that's what we'll be doing today. We'll just match some jewels. So, has anyone it's like if you played match-3 games, do you know the core mechanics? How does it work? I'll just explain it in a few words. So the basic algorithm is that we swipe. So we have the board, we swipe two given items, we find matches, we remove them, we scroll the board accordingly to the column, generate new items, find the items which are affected by the one which were removed, and for all of this we do the same. So what we can have here? So we can have match-3, which is the basic idea. So if we swipe here is the match, we'll remove this, that will go scroll down, and everything above and here might generate new matches, so we'll have to check that too. We can have double match-3, so if we swipe them once, we'll get double match. We'll have to remove all of them, scroll everything, and go again. We can have match-4, so here is the swipe, or the other way, we have match-4, we remove all of that, scroll the column, and check everything which could be affected afterwards. We can have even match-5, not the best picture, sorry about that. So let's imagine that here is the red one, we'll swipe it and we'll get the match. Sorry about that, it's not exactly what I wanted. We can have match L, so for example we'll swipe this one and we'll have match L. That's basically all the matches we can have. And as I said before, we can generate the new matches. So for example, if we had a match here, we remove them and this one will be scrolled down and that will generate a new match which will have to be removed and the process will have to carry on. Everyone understand more or less how match-3 works?
So if you swipe, it swaps the pair.
Yeah. So if you swipe like that. So if the swipe is not a winning one, we'll just come back to the position they were in the before the swipe. So in order to make our game, we have some requirements. Well, we don't, but we'll use some. So that's what we'll be using. C++ 14, STL, Emscripten, which is 135 on Mac currently. We can compile with GCC 6, but we cannot compile it for the web because Emscripten doesn't support GCC. So what are the dependencies? SDL2. Well, we could use SFML or another library or OpenGL. However, OpenGL and SDL2 is supported by Emscripten out of the box, so we don't have to do anything. We just compile with it. Yeah.
Do you know the current state of SFML? Because they have added mobile support, so I'm not sure if it now compiles on Emscripten. Have you ever tried that?
Yeah, I logged into it. So the question is whether the SFML is supported by Emscripten. And according to my knowledge, it's not yet. I've seen that people were trying to do it. However, the port is not done yet. So maybe there's like a prototype, but there's no stable version which we can use.
What does SDL2 do? What kind of
Okay. Sorry about that. So SDL is the graphic library. So, you know, it's like if you want to show the image, or a pixel or anything, we have to use some library. Or we can use OpenGL. However, SDL2, you know, makes our life easier because it creates a, you know, window. We can open a PNG and just show it. We don't have to deal with, you know, low-level stuff, which we don't care here. So in order to open the image, we use SDL2 image. In order to show text, we use TTF, which has fonts. So, yeah, this talk will use Boost.DI. So, for people who haven't been on the talk, DI is just responsible for creating objects for the tree we have. So in this case, we have the tree with the MVC. It will just create an app, and all the dependencies will be injected accordingly to the bindings. So we don't have to deal with that. So in a sense that, because this talk is more about example, real life example, how to use libraries which I proposed, as well as the ranges, and Emscripten, obviously. MSM-lite, so that's the library to state machine library. So here, we'll just use the state machine instead of, as our control, we'll use state machine and not ifs and else and branches. So the way it works, we have a transition table, we have a transition from one state to another, and we'll just process events which will be given us from the SDL. We'll look how that's done a bit later. And then finally, we'll use ranges. Has anyone used ranges already? So yeah, ranges are proposed to the standard as a replacement for STL, maybe in the future. So the way difference is that we have we don't have iterators, we have ranges. We'll look how it's done. It's like that example from Eric Snibler Fibonacci, I guess, or yeah, Fibonacci. We'll look how it's done in the game. So what about the design? We'll use MVC. We obviously could use like entity component system or any other design for that. However, MVC is quite easy to use for our purpose, as well as we can use it for apps. So here, although we make a game, we can easily change it to the application. And entity component system would be more for games. It's hard for me to imagine entity component system with applications. So anyone, everyone knows how to use MVC? No, I think that's quite obvious. We just try to separate the logic from the UI. We can use it on top of entity component system too. So what we have, so that's the rough design of our game. We have game, we have controller, which will process events. We have the view, we have some simple animations. The view will use canvas, which will be based on the SDL, and the board is our board, which will have some properties with the colors and the grids. Is that more or less feasible? We have some state diagrams. I don't know whether that's visible. So for example, how the swap will work. So we are in the state idle. We wait for the first item. We have the someone click the button or do the swipe. We wait for the second item. After that, we do the match. If the match is winning, we go to the matches. If the match is not winning, we just swipe again and come back to the waiting for the first item. We'll look how it's actually done in the code as well. And how we handle the matches, we just verify whether the matches are winning, and we just do we have to find the matches, destroy the matches, scroll the board, generate new. It's just from the algorithm how to match-3 actually does work. And after that, we do it again for the new ones, as long as we have some matches in the queue. So just how quickly have to compile that, because for the Emscripten it's a bit different. So that's, I guess, pretty straightforward. Have to compile that for the desktop. We just use SDL, SDL2 image and TTF. We compile it and just run it. Nothing special about that. We can see make Emscripten. So here it's the whole process how to install it, but I won't be going through that because you can do it yourself. What is interesting is how to compile that. So here we're actually not using the libraries provided. We say use SDL image, and the way Emscripten works, it will download the ported version to the Emscripten, and will just compile it for us. So we don't have to care and do anything about it. From the options which are quite interesting, it's emrun, which will print all the logs to the console. It's quite useful, especially when you try to check, you know, on device. You would like to see some logs, because otherwise it's quite hard to follow what is happening. I think the most important option is this one, which I was looking for like an hour, because I didn't know why images did, because here we preload the data, because obviously it's HTML and JavaScript, so we do not load it from the local disk. We have to have it in the package, and here we just say use it. Otherwise, we would have to do it in the code, which is not that that nice. We can have a template for the HTML we provide. That's the way we run. This one is quite useful, because we can create a simple HTTP server and just run it locally instead of using it this way. Because this way, for example, on Chrome, we won't be able to run it easily because of the cross-reference, and we won't be able to see the images. So this way we can actually put it on the device as well and check it out there. And we can use CMake. So here it's just a small information about the compilation times. Unfortunately, Rangers, although they are awesome, they do not compile it very fast yet. Eric Nibbler is aware of that, and probably that will be fixed sooner or later, if anyone will fix it. So you can see that they add like 7 seconds to compilation, which is not that good yet. But it's not that bad, so we can deal with that. Okay, so is that more or less clear so far? Any questions? All right, so let's go to the implementation. So how it's done? I like to start from the main. So this part is the tutorial. So I'll explain the basics, and after that we'll try to implement some new features on top of that. We won't start from scratch, because it's a bit longer than an hour and a half to do the game, especially with ranges. So the logic and everything is there. We'll just add some features and see how useful all the libraries might be for doing that. So it's our main. We use DI to create the game. This way, we don't have to care about dependencies, as I said before. So the basic idea is just in the main, we create the injector and the game, and we just play it.
Your use of random is wrong.
Why?
It's like, because you're creating a local pseudo-random number generator, which is immediately used, and then it's destroyed and never used again. You might as well just use random device directly.
Maybe. Well, it generates some random numbers.
It's just inefficient.
If you're going to use a pseudo-random number generator, you want to create it once and keep using the same.
Yeah, that's a fair point. Yeah. So the comment is that the random generator should be created once instead of all the time. However, it's like I didn't, bother about that much. For me, it was just important that it should create some random numbers. So let's move to the configuration. So as you've seen from the design, we have the canvas. So we'll just bind canvas to the SDL canvas, because that's the one we will use. Here, it's not a C++ 14, that's C99. However, it does work. So it's just for the visibility. In the C++ 14, we would have to get rid of the names. But just for the purpose of this presentation, I just show it. So we have some basic configuration with title, the size of the window, the board size and how many colors we have. We have the basic board. So basically, that's the initial board we will play. So if you have imagination, yeah? There's a question.
I have a hard time believing that this is not a dangling reference.
Which one?
The initial board. Like it's a, you bind what is basically a pointer?
No, that's...
Do a local initializer list.
Well, you can see the pointer. That's not a pointer.
Color array without bounds.
So that's the vector, sorry. So so in a sense, that's the way DI works. So bind the color means that this bracket is just a notation. It's okay. It means that it might be converted to anything which is a container. So we can bind it to vector, array, set, or whatever. It's just the notation because we don't want to write bind it to vector or bind it to set. So we use a notation. Well, that's the notation I figured out might be useful. But yeah, I didn't explain that. So the board itself has a vector in it. So this initializer list will be passed to the vector. As and the randomize, we have to bind it because the wrong one. So we have to bind it in order to be able to fake it in the test, because otherwise it would be hard to write the test with everything being random. We wouldn't be able to fake it. So is the configuration more or less clear? Can go further? All right. So let's go to maybe board. So as you can see, let's keep that. It's just basically int, color is the int. And here we have grid, which is just a vector of colors, which was bind from the configuration. So when we start the game, the DI will put grids into, will initialize grids into the board, which was the initializer list. We have our configuration. Nothing special about that. We just have some data here, which will be initialized by DI. Let's just look at the view. There's no. I didn't care much about the view, so we won't focus on that. We just have the basic functionality like load image, create text, draw, render. And that's just simple implementation using SDL2. So we'll just draw. It's like, I don't want to explain that much. It's like if no one have been using SDL, that might be a bit weird how it's done. However, it's just we just use SDL to load the image and render all the grids. It's just basic simple programming in the graphic. What about the view? Well, view itself, it's not magical too. We just load the images, set the grid, update the grid, get position. We won't focus much on that, yeah?
Is there a question? Can you use a shared pointer for the SDL resources?
That's a really good question. The question is why the shared pointer is used for the resources. The only reason is that it was easier to, because the problem with the SDL is that it's C and you have to bind the destroy. With the shared pointer, it's just easier to pass the custom deleter. We can do that with the unique pointer, yeah, that's a fair point. It should be a unique pointer because we don't share that. However, I didn't care about the view itself, so I just did what was easier. But that's a really good point. What about the animations? Simplest animations system ever. We can play one animation at a time. So that's the limit. We just go through all the animations. We check the beginning, animate, update, the view update, and after that we remove whether they are not visible anymore. It's really simple, because the view is not something we would like to focus on. Yeah, that's a question?
I don't understand this async limit thing in this function.
There isn't, because the async limit is just, it doesn't have any purpose yet, let's say, because if the animation system would be more complex, probably you would like to play some animations at the same time and some animations after each other. However, here, the system is just simplified in order to play one by one. But it's written this way, so in the future it will be easy to extend. I wouldn't really focus on that because it's just a view part, which I'm actually going to hide, as it's not important for this talk. Let's go to the game, which I should covered before. Sorry about that. So the game is the main entry for the application. And here is the difference between Emscripten and the desktop. It's not a huge difference. It might be somehow done in the same way, but it didn't work for me as much. So the way it works, it depends on the controller, because we'll process events from the SDL. So let's go to the play. At first, DI will inject the controller for us, so we don't have to care about that. And after that, it's like, here is a macro. Sorry about that. It's just Emscripten. So in case of Emscripten, we have the macro for Emscripten. Otherwise, we don't do anything, because there's a small difference how it's handled. I couldn't make it happen the same way, so sorry about it. Because we don't have this function, for example, on desktop, so we have to somehow get rid of it on the desktop. So the Emscripten set main loop arg is responsible to create a main loop. And because of the JavaScript, it's handled differently. So we don't have a while like here. All the events are, we don't have a main loop in the JavaScript, because the JavaScript is handled by the browser. So we don't have to handle the loop, because when the game won't stop although the loop, like the main is finished. It will still be handled in the JavaScript. So that's the difference, and therefore we have to handle it differently. So we have the play implementation, which basically get the old events. So make dispatch table is just an easy way for us to create to pass the runtime event from the SDL to the control. So the way it works, it creates a jump table for the SDL event from SDL quit to whatever event is that. It's quite far in the events list from the SDL. We have the time tick, which is like game update. So if you have a game loop in the game programming, it's usually we just update it every time. So here is the same approach. We just pull the event and dispatch the event from the dispatch table to the controller. And we wait as long, and we do it as long in the desktop version as we are not in the terminate state. So that's from the MSVC. So when we go to the terminate state, we finish it. Is that more or less clear? It's just basic game loop. So right now, let's go to the fun part, the logic. This part is written using ranges. It was somewhat reviewed by Eric, but not much. So hopefully there are not a lot of mistakes here. I'm not an expert with ranges, because this is just a new one. So the idea is, we actually had a talk about Array's view yesterday. Here, we'll use a bit different approach. We'll have a vector, which is basically one, it's a flattened array in that sense. And we'll use row and column to figure out two dimensions, because otherwise it's really hard to do that with ranges. So instead of have array with two dimensions, we'll have flatten one, and we'll have views for the rows and columns. This way we can handle dimensions with the ranges and after that operate on it. The problem with ranges is the fact that currently they do not support const expression like compile time views, so we pay for that. Although we wouldn't have to in a sense because we know the board size and we would be able to get it at compile time. However, right now it doesn't work. So I'll just show the test for that so it will be easier to follow. So the basic idea for the row, that's our board. However, it's flattened, so it's like that. It's just long list. When we ask for the row one, it will just select the values from the row one. And the way it's done, we use ranges view for that. We can use the slice here. However, slice is not the slice. Both parameters for the slice, the begin and the end, starts from the beginning of the array. So we would have to say the width times end twice. So I find the drop and take easier. However, we can use slice as well. So this is a way to do it. We just drop 1, 2, 3 and just get how many we want. So this way, for example, in our test, simple test, sorry, it's not that visible. So if we take the row, here we have the width and the row which we want to take. So if width is 2, we just split it like that and take the row 0, we'll take this one. So basically just drop and take. Is that clear? That, I think that's simple. Yeah? So the question is about the unit test framework. It's not really a unit test framework. Sorry. It's not the standard solution as well, sorry about that. So I just use string literals in order to get the name, and after that, when we have equals operator, we just run it. I like it because I can write the name and just test. This way it's just easier to see. We don't have to use macros for that. Is that all right? So what about the column? Well, column will be pretty much the same. Sorry about these conversions. Emscripten, although it's based on Clang 3.7, has some issues with compiling ranges with auto. So sometimes I had to convert it to int because otherwise it didn't work. It does work on desktop, but on the Clang, which is provided with Emscripten, it doesn't. So there will be a few casks here. Sorry about that. So to get the column, we just use the stride. Stride will just take the mode of the value. So it will just, when we have the flattened one, we'll just take whether the position mode, the width, will be 0. And this way we'll just take those ones. We can implement it differently. It was suggested by Eric. This one is the easiest way. Is that clear? So we can have the test as well for that. So we'll just grab 2, and we'll just take the column, which will take every n one. So this way, we have column and row, which is pretty awesome already. So what about match? In order to get match, match is obviously more complex than the row column. Here is the conversion I had to do, otherwise it didn't compile. So here we can use match n. What we'll return is the beginning of the match and the length. So for example, on the top we can see that we will try to match the color 3 on the position 3, and we would like to get the beginning of the match and the length. In the second case, the length should be higher because there are 4 elements. So how we can do that? Well, we can use renders for that too. So we'll get, we'll take elements, we'll transform, and after that we'll just count. So basically, the way it will work, we'll just go and take like n elements, one, and we'll just move for one. And inside of these phrase, we'll verify whether they are the same color. And this one is done here, whether they are the same. And we'll get the view with 1, 1, 0, 1, depending on how many matches we have. And in order to verify that, we just get how many matches, so how many ones, truths are there. And we'll count them for the length, and we'll return the beginning and the length in the end. So if you look in the test, we can see here, for example, so that's the fail case, but in the proper case, we will try to find the match for this view. And the view obviously will take from the row or column, and we'll just try to find the match. So we'll get, that will be 0, that will be 1, that will be 0. So we know that the 1 means that there is one match 3, and we'll just return the beginning and the end. So the beginning is 1, and the length is 3. If you had here 3 as well, that will be 1, that will be 1. So it means it's 2, so it means it will be match 4. And the same way, match 5, and vice versa. Is that more or less clear? It's like we have to do it some way. That's the way I figured out. It might be done totally differently as well. So what about match? Because that's not enough for us to get the match. So when we have a match, when we have a board, and we swipe something, for example, this part, we'll have to check both of them for the match. And the match might be in the row or on the column. So we have to check both. So we have the match n. So the way we do it, we take the row. So we have the value. So for example, let's look at the top one. So value 13. Let's go here. That's the one. That's the match we would like to have. We have, so in this one, we get the row and the column. That will be the view which we'll check with the match n. So we'll go from this one, we'll go like that, like that, like that. And that would return a match for us. And here, we just check whether the match is there. So meaning the length is not 0. So this way, we know that we have a match. The match itself is responsible to give us the match. So in this case, it will be match L. So what we would like to have is to return the positions of the match. So we would like to return these values out of the board we have. So we swap, we select this one, we do it for the row and the column, and we just take the values. So we just combine them here and return the vector out of them. We sort and unique them because they, for example, this one will be twice. And we need the values in order to remove them, because the next step will be to remove all of them and scroll the board. So that's the match. The next part is just to scroll. Because removing, it's just easy. We just remove them with 0. So that's not a big deal for us. We just transform. How we would like to scroll, when we have this point. So here was the match. We remove those, They are not visible right now, and we would like to scroll down this view, because we always scroll in the columns. And after that, here, we'll generate the new ones. So the way we can do that, we can just use rotate. So we have the view. It's the column view. And after that, we just rotate the amount of elements which are above. So everyone knows how the rotate works? If no, you can ask Sean. He likes this algorithm. So in a sense, it will just move them down and this up. So we just rotate them. It's really useful for us when you have the column view, because we can just rotate and the work is done for us. And the last one, I think, yeah. The last one is for us. So when we scroll the board, we have everything sorted in a sense. We have to find the elements which will be affected by the match, because all of them may potentially trigger a new match as in the next level. So when we have a match like that, we'll remove all of that. In the end, this one will be scrolled down. On the top will be the new ones, but all of them, depending on the board, could have generated a new matches. So for example, if we scroll 777 and here would be a 7, we would have to check that as well. And the way we would do that is just from getting the values which are here and just check whether they are swaps or not. And that's pretty much it what we need from the logic. Is that more or less clear? Yeah?
Wouldn't it be easier to just check the whole board again after a match?
We could have checked all the boards again. Whether that would be easier or not, I don't know. It's not that hard to, in just one liner in a sense, with the ranges. I just wanted to show it this way. Obviously, we can check all the boards all the time as well. So the comment was that whether it would be easier to check the whole board. Could be. I just wanted to show that, let's say the checking whole board is expensive operation, so we can do
if
it.
You're playing with 1,000 by 1,000.
Yeah, if you play like on the device 1,000 by 1,000. Well, depending on your algorithm. Okay. So let's just go to the main part of the game, which is the controller. So control is done using MSVC. So that's the state machine, the basic state machine, which I shown a bit of the class state diagram for that. But I will explain that, because it's not that obvious, I guess. So we will use the reverse notation. So store state, destination state, event, guards, actions. And how we will handle that. So we have four regions, which are orthogonal, which means that they are pseudo parallel. So an event might be handled by, sorry about that. Should go for the planning. So moving back, we have regions which will handle the events which may occur. So how does it work? We are in the idle. Wait for the first item. That's the anonymous transition. So that will start immediately when we have the controller being created. We will show the board. Show the board is just simple lambda. We can write lambda in place here. I'll show how to do it. Or we can just extract it and just go somewhere else. So here it's just show board. We just queue the animation to show the grids. Nothing special about that. So here is the basic mechanism. We wait for the first item. When the button is down, we select the item. We go to the waiting for the second item. The button is up because we swipe. So we click the button. And after that, on the different grid, we do not push it anymore. And this way, we know two positions. The first one is when the button is down, and the second one is the button is up. We check whether it's allowed. Obviously, not all swipes are allowed. So if we have a board and we swipe from top corner to the bottom corner, we don't want that to be allowed, because that would be a bit of cheating. So they have to be a neighbor. Maybe we can log into it. It's allowed. So we verify we have an event. So I didn't explain that, so maybe it would be a good point. So all these parts will be injected via DI. We don't have to care about that. We can change the order, we can change and add parameters, and we don't have to change anything else. It will be just passed for us. So here is an event, which will be button. We get the position, and we verify whether the both positions, which one was selected, which we just push back to the list, and the one which occurs right now is pretty much a neighbor. And the neighbor means that the div is one, and they have to be in the board, yeah. So when we have that, so right now we have two options. Select the item is just pushed to the list, so I won't show that. So whether is allowed, we select the second item and we swap the items. So swap the items is just swap, basically. So we have two positions and we just swap them on the board and see what will happen. When it's not allowed, well, we don't care, we just drop it. So right now, we go to the match items. We verify whether the swap is winning. And we verify that quite easily because we have is match. So we verify whether the position for the swipe, the first element and the second element is winning or not. If it is match, we queue the matches, which RET equals 2 because we have two positions. If not, here it means that here is not items is not winning. We swap them again, meaning that we come back to the situation which was before. Clear everything, show the swap, meaning that nothing has happened. We just had a swipe, and after that come back to the situation it was. So in case of handle matches, which means that the swap was winning, this one will trigger a queue event, and when we come back to the table, the matches will be triggered from the handle matches. And this way, we verify whether we have items, if they are winning, and we'll go through the algorithm I shown. So here is just find matches. So we'll just use the logic which was provided. So here we have few matches. For all of them, we get the match, and we just sort them. So it means that we'll try to get all matches which were triggered by it. And destroy matches is just really simple. We just set it to 0, basically. We scroll the board. We just use the scroll for all matches. We have the logic, so we don't have to do much here. We generate the new. We use our simple randomizer, which somewhat will generate random numbers for all elements. And after that, we just queue the event with the RT, which is 1, because for all selected, for all matches, we can have a new matches, and we'll just go again and again, as long as we have items. If you don't have items, we're done. In case when the matches are not winning, we just drop it. And we just go again. We also have the region in case where we press the button. So if the key is escape, we just go to terminate state. So that was the game loop. We verified whether we are in the X. So that's the way how long we play. In the JavaScript, we don't care about it because we can't just finish the browser with escape. So we don't care about it. And the last one is the handle matches. We just happen handle animations. We just happen every time the game loop. We just update the animations. So that's basically the idea. Is that more or less clear? Yeah, there's a question.
I haven't seen the MSM talk, so I might be confused by this. But isn't the on the right side? Isn't that the preconditioned state for something to happen?
So here here there's a source state.
Yeah.
Here destination state.
Yeah.
Here is the event,
yeah,
which triggers.
Yes. So in handle animations, what does the star before that mean?
Ah, okay.
Because
so sorry about
it. As far as I see, this state machine is never in the handle animation state.
Okay, sorry about it. So the question was about the star, and the star is just the initial state. So we have this one is initial state, this one is initial state, this one is initial state, and this one, which means that we have
multiple
initial states, which means that we have multiple orthogonal regions. So all of them are like in, you can think about them like in parallel. So this one is parallel, this one, and this one. Yeah, sorry about that. So maybe we can run it. So let's make an app. Sorry about the slow compilation, it's not due to DI or MSM, it's just ranges. Okay. And let's play it. Or not. Oh, just sorry. I'll just do it again. Sorry about that. I was in the Emscripten, so it didn't work. So obviously, for the Emscripten, we'll see it in a second. We have to do it a bit differently. Okay. So we have the game. Woo. We can, so how does work? So when we swipe, so I push the button and then, so that's the way it works for the one which would not be winning one. If you have a winning, we'll just scroll the board. And we'll just go and go and go. So that's the way it works. And let's do more crazy stuff. We have to remove it. So we'll compile it for the Emscripten. So as you see, we'll use EM++, which is the Emscripten clang. We have a target. It compiles pretty much the same as the other one. It just
single JavaScript file?
No, well, there will be a few files. It will be an index.html, and it will be, we can see how many files we have. We have index.html, data, JavaScript, some memory. It's just basic mappings for to make it faster. We can even look how it actually looks. That's the way it looks in JavaScript. It's not really usable, I guess. I wouldn't like to edit that. However, it's done this way because it might be faster. That's the way Emscripten gets the speed, because no one would write code like that. But the code like that might be generated.
How big is that file?
So this one. Yeah. Oh, sorry.
I mean, it does include pull all of SDL compile, or maybe not the whole, but it includes an SDL port to the browser.
In the C library.
Let's open it.
Yes.
You can play it too. And it's basically the same, yeah? It's like the speed is the same, more or less, because there is nothing much to do, so we don't pay for animations because there are no animations here. Okay, so that's the idea. Any questions regarding to the idea? Yeah?
Regarding Emscripten, how does it handle multithreading?
Well, the question is about multithreading and Emscripten. I guess Emscripten prefers single-threaded applications.
So it just doesn't compile?
I think it will compile, but may not work properly because of the JavaScript. For example, when I had a SDL timer in a different thread, there were some issues. However, I've seen on the Emscripten website that it is supported, but maybe not as good as the single thread application, because usually Emscripten is used to port our games, or maybe write something new, but yeah.
You can do a few things with Emscripten. You can use something called web workers, but in that case you can't share any memory, so you can only post message from one to another.
Okay.
Post message. You can use a thing called asyncify in Emscripten that basically adds like callbacks, so it just unwinds the stack back and forth.
Okay, that's interesting.
Things, which is horrible. Or if you enable a flag in Chrome or Firefox, there's a thing called shared array buffers, which Emscripten supports, which allows you to use threads and atomics.
Okay.
It's still experimental, and it's not in the JavaScript standard yet.
Okay, yeah, so I won't repeat all the comments, sorry. Basically, the comment was that it is possible, it's quite experimental, but probably it will be in the next versions, more or less. Let's hope for it. Okay, so let's do the fun part and let's edit something. So to demonstrate, for example, DI, we can, for example, show that when we change order of anything, it won't affect us. Oh, sorry, I will have to switch to this one. It's quite annoying because Emscripten uses a different compiler.
Do you use the same anytime trick for lambdas as it did in EcoStructures?
Yeah, that's exactly the same one. Here, MSM-lite works the way that that is lambda, it will just get the function trait out of it, and for it, for all the types, we'll just get. Actually, here we don't have to use the same trick because that's a function. So we'll just get the call operator and function trait of that, and we have the types. Yeah, as you can see, it compiles. So in regards of DI, it's quite easy to manipulate.
Again, if it is a generic lambda, does the function trait stuff work?
Generic lambda? Yeah, so that's a. You mean like with auto here?
Yeah, like show matches as a constant or a graph.
So here, auto, we can have one auto, which means that is it an event. So.
And DI works with function traits?
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. So the question was about whether the auto will be injected, in a sense, whether the generic lambdas will be supported. So in case of MSM-lite and DI, when we have a function trait and we have one generic type, the way it works, it will just inject the event. We can also change the order here, we don't really care. So I'll just implement one maybe feature because we don't have much time, sorry about that. So for example, if you want to have, I don't know, points, let's add points quickly. So for example, we can start like that. I'll just use, I don't know, int for point. What we can do with that? When we would like to add points, probably when we have a match winning. So it's swap winning. And since we have the MSM-lite, we can just get here points. Well, we maybe would like to add points as many much as we have. So that would be the event. I think there's matches. I'll just verify it for a sec. We have an event here. So we have a matches, which has a vector with matches. So if we go back, we'll add that. And we'll show points. So here, the idea is that we have a lambda. We get the points from the DI and the event from DI. We add the points, as many as we have matches. And we'll show points, which we don't have. But that might be quite easy to implement by copy-paste. So what we need animations, view, and points. We actually can have it like that. The set order is not important. Do we have show taxi? No. So what we need, we have animations. We create a lambda with view and point. And what? And view show text. Still don't remember the function. I think it's show text. I just have to go to view. Sorry, I don't remember how it's done. So we have set text. View set text. Points. To string p, let's say 10, whatever.
Change the name to show points instead of show matches.
Great point.
You're missing a close parents after the lambda.
Okay. Will that work? No idea. So we also show the points in the beginning. I guess. So let's revise. We have show points, which will just get the animation, view, and point. We'll queue the animation to set the text somewhere. And we'll show it in the beginning and when we get some matches. Yeah, that should do it. Probably won't compile. Obviously it won't. No member named.
There's no event in this handler. Shouldn't that be somewhere further down? Shouldn't that be...
No, because that's when the item is winning. So we know the swap is winning here, yeah? So that's the...
Yes, but first that would mean that only the very first destroyed items give points and not the chain reaction. And also, I just don't think there's a matches event here, because you only create that matches event afterwards. So I think that should be in the,
okay,
in the handle matches handlers.
Hmm. We can add it here. That's true. Let's add it here. Yeah, we have matches. Yeah, that's a better point. That's a good point. It
probably should be after find matches, because that's where the matches vector is filled.
Another good point. Why it doesn't work?
Well, you just have two commas because after show points you have a comma and then the next line you have one too.
Thank you. It's always hard to do the demo. Yeah. Wasn't that hard? Let's verify it. Yay, it seems to be working. Yeah, it was a really good point because otherwise, as you've probably seen, the error I made was that we wouldn't get the points for the new matches. We would just get for the first one. So yeah, so maybe I won't be doing much more live coding, as it's really stressful, and try to do something crazy. So, as we have a bit of time, oh, actually, I wanted to show you the test as well. So let's just see how it's done, especially functional tests. So, when you have a board, we would like to verify how that works. And the functional test will look the way that we basically imitate the user. So you have some swipe. So swipe is basically an event which will be triggered when we swipe. So we emulate that. We'll use fake it to fake the canvas. This way we don't have to do anything. And the way it's done with DI is that we have a mox provider, which is here. And mox provider will create a get mock in case of polymorphic types. So if you have another polymorphic type, we'll just create an object. Otherwise, we'll just get the fake one from the fake mock, fake it. So obviously we bind some board, we have our customized randomize, we just return the numbers. And what we do here is the way we fake it. We don't have to use, like in the Google mock, any macros. We just get it here. And when we create the controller, we do the swipe. So we swipe somewhere here, and so we swipe on the top. So we swipe here, and we expect that the board will be scrolled, and that will be the new element, which will be randomized from the our randomizer. If we look into that, we can compare the boards. But I won't do that because we don't have as much time. Is that more or less clear how we can write the functional test for that? So basically, the idea is that we emulate the user, we swipe, so that's like the user will do it. And after that, we can just verify the board whether it's there with the proper values. We can have different tests. The basic idea is that with the DI, we don't have to care about mocking or anything like that. With the fake it, as well as DI, we can just use mock providers and ask DI to create mocks for us, which is quite useful. We don't have to do much in order to test anything. And as I said before, I would like to show you something more crazy. Let's try something crazy. So I was thinking about it, and what about compiling the JavaScript and after that try to run it on device in the browser? It's a bit weird because obviously on the device you would compile the application itself. But with this approach we can actually try it and see that we can compile JavaScript, open it in the browser on the device, and we have our cross-platform application. In order to do so, we'll have to have a bit of JavaScript in C++, which sounds quite crazy. However, it is possible with the Emscripten. So this way, we'll verify whether we actually are in the device or on the browser in the desktop, because we have to change the behavior, because click doesn't work on device. So we don't click on device. On device, we just touch it. So that's the difference, and we will have to change that. So in order to verify it, we verify whether the browser is iPhone, iPod, Android. Probably Windows should be there, but sorry, Windows. I don't remember. It's Explorer, I guess. So the thing will have to change. So that's the button down, button up for the desktop case. However, for the for the mobile, we have touch down and touch up. What are the problems with this approach? On Android, actually, it works quite awesome. I haven't seen any delay. However, on iOS, we don't have full screen, because full screen is not allowed. So we have to, you know, maximize it ourselves. And on top of that, it's quite slow, because JS is not compiled, and it's interpreter. So it's not as a good solution for iOS, but on Android, actually, will work. And we'll see that in a second. I will just set our version and show you the changes. So in order to do that, I won't be doing it live, as it's too stressful for me, sorry. So in order to do so, that's a nice trick here. I don't know if you haven't been on the MSM-lite talk. It's quite fun that if we have a guard with this bracket, we cannot use lambda here, because the compiler will say that it's generalized attribute. So to avoid that, we can negate the predicate, and it will compile.
So is there a reason you don't just put the whole thing in parentheses?
Parentheses? I don't know if that would work.
Because the parentheses would interrupt the attribute part.
Maybe
as an attribute.
Maybe that's an idea. I don't know, we can try it quickly. Maybe that would be a solution. Seems like it's working. Yeah. Thank you for that, Ashley. It's pretty good. So we don't have to negate. We can use the parentheses. So the difference here is the fact that whether we are in the mobile, so that's the JavaScript code which verifies whether we are in the browser, mobile browser, or the normal one. We use the touchdown. Otherwise, we'll use the button down and up. And this way, we can distinguish it. I just wanted you to show the difference between lambdas. So for example, here, I think we have the same code twice. So with this approach, we can easily change that to a lambda. Reset, for example. We'll create the lambda here.
Already has something called reset.
Reset all, or maybe reset and show would be more accurate. Reset and show, and I guess here as well. So that's the way we can easily refactor the code and the transition table to make it more visible for us. Obviously, it depends on the approach, whether I like when everything is visible on the, you know, on the transition table, but sometimes, well, you cannot have too much. Approach for that is as well the composite state, which means that we can move this part in the different controller, different state machine, and just here use it as a state. So let's compile that for the browser. We'll have to change it again. Make web. Have to wait a few seconds. Linking. Okay, it's there. We can open it as before. So this version will work. So here we use button click instead of touch down and touch up. And right now I will just deploy it to the device. So in order to do that, we can use Emscripten. We have em run. So what this one is doing, it just create a local server, and on the and open the port for that, so we can go to localhost. I guess we can. One thing doesn't work. Oh, sorry. Okay. So it's still the same version, it's just on the local port. This way, I'll try to open the Chrome. The way Chrome works, we can inspect. So that's the way we can, for example, verify whether our application works on device. I'll just go. And I have to click here. It's not actually connected. So I'll just open it on the browser. Localhost. So you can see it here. I can even swipe. And right now we can go here. So I will swipe it here. And we have if you see it, it's I can swipe it here as well. It's quite cool. I can show it on iOS as well. So as you see, on iOS, I don't have full screen. I have to kind of move it. And when I swipe, as you see, it's a bit slower. You can see the delay, but it still does work. You can actually, I don't know, I won't maybe give you my IP here, but if you go to the website, you can actually see it yourself. If I'll go back, so that's the way we can debug it. So we just use Chrome for that on Android, and that's what we've seen. On iOS, we can use Safari Web Inspector. It's a bit more complex, but it's still doable. So that's my record. If you want to play, you can try and beat it.
In 0 moves.
No, so that's the functionality I don't think we have time to do. However, when I planned the session, I wanted to add the moves as well. So we can maybe quickly look into the code for that. How does work? So here we have moves. So moves.
Did you make points along and moves an inch
just to distinguish the types? However, usually you would, because with the DI, if you have the same type, it's hard to distinguish. You have to name named parameters, which is not that awesome, or just do the different types. So here I just done it. Usually you would have probably an interface or whatever, either way. So this one is just a simple example, but that's the good point. So the way it works, here we have. So when we are in the first item and the moves, and we don't have many moves, we shove the game over, we just print the game over text, and we move to the click, wait for the button in order to reset and show, which means that we reset all the board and everything, and we just show it again from the beginning. And we decrease the number of moves here. Oh, that's the way I wanted to. I think that's the reason why I wanted to do it in the points, because that's the way we decrease the number of moves. So we just get the moves and we just decrease them with the lambda. We can use the normal lambda too. And to show the moves, we just use key animations. Show the moves. We can maybe try something. We don't have much time. So for example, if you'd like to move that to the lambda, we can just do like the moves. And that's pretty much it. And we'll have to compile that. So in this way, we can easily extract more complex lambdas the way we've done it here. And so I don't know if we have time still. We have 5 minutes. Are there any questions related to? Okay.
So where does the state machine get associated with the injector?
Mm-hmm. So, okay. So let's go through that. So the first part is the game. So controller is the state machine. So here we'll inject the controller. And controller is the state machine. Controller constructor, that's the MSVC, the way it works, is the constructor of the controller takes all the dependencies which are required for all the guards as a constructor parameters. So the way it works, it gets all of that, it checks all the parameters, what is required, get the unique list of it, and these parameters required to be passed via the constructor. This way you have dependencies in the controller, and after that, when we call the lambda, we just get parameters, for example, moves. Oh, function traits, I need moves. So we have dependencies in the control, get me the moves. And it will pass the moves to the predicate, and it will just call it. In case of auto, it will just pass event as well. Is that answering the question? Okay, so I guess we don't have much more time. So are there any questions related to anything which we've done today? So this one is the fake repository in order to fake the mocks. Instead of, for example, Google mock, we can use fake it. We don't have to write the macros. ranges. We'll use the logic for that. MSM-lite was the controller, which was explained. DI was to glue it all together. And that's the game. You can take the code and play it online. I guess that's basically it. Are there any questions? Yeah?
I have an unrelated question. I find the topic of using C++ for web development really interesting. Mm-hmm. And is there anything that you recommend for doing like server-side programming in C++?
And
frameworks or...
Would you like to have a server-side in on the website?
Yeah, I'm just wondering. Just, you know, is there anything that's kind of like Node.js, but you could use C++?
Yeah, it's like I guess like WebAssembly is something.
Where you could write C++ and compile it down to JavaScript and run it on Node.js.
Yeah, Emscripten, the way Emscripten works, it creates the JavaScript. Yeah, however, WebAssembly will create a binary, let's say, yeah, for the web, which will be a standard.
But I think the question was, okay, what would you recommend as a server-side framework for writing server-side code in C++?
Like if you wanted to handle like, you know,
multiplayer.
Yeah, multiplayer is a perfect example. Yeah.
Yeah, wraps up. It's a state of the art. But it works quite well in C++. Has a few libraries.
Okay.
Works in the browser. Not sure if they like.
What type of server would you use for the
just they're like WebSocket libraries. I don't know.
WebSocket libraries. Okay.
There's no special framework I use.
I haven't done it, and I'm just curious. That's why I'm asking.
Yeah, it's like server side is obviously not that easy in C++. We don't have a lot of libraries. Yeah. You can use ASIO, I guess, but it depends what you want to achieve. Yeah, it's hard to say which one would be the best. Any more questions? Not? Thank you.